Welcome to Boise State in the Community. I'm your host, Cy McChunkin. And here at Boise State in the Community, we're not just a show, but we're also a class filled with students that are just trying to learn the basics of studio broadcasting. We also bring in guests from the community to come in here and tell us a little bit about themselves. Now here with me, I have a special guest, and she's got a doctorate in literacy. She taught middle school, and this is her third year at BSU. Please welcome Dr. Catherine Wright.
Thanks so much for having me.
So how are you doing this evening?
I'm doing pretty well. How are you?
I'm doing all right. Got here safely through the snow.
Yeah, that's an accomplishment today.
So can you tell me a little bit about how you sort of came to the literacy profession?
Sure. I started off as a middle school history and English teacher. I was certified in both areas because the job market's not great, and so I wanted to be marketable. So my certification was originally secondary, which meant that no one ever taught me how to teach someone how to read. The assumption is that by the time children hit middle school, they've got it, they can do it. And that's just not the truth at all. And I personally was someone who very much struggled learning to read. So I could really sympathize with my students, but I didn't feel like I had a lot to offer them. So I went to Texas A&M University with the intention of learning more about, all right, what do we do for these kids? So ideally, we can fix early education and maybe they'll all be great readers by second or third grade, but we have kids who are coming in and for whatever reason, be it that they have a learning disability or maybe they're new to the country and they're learning the language, or maybe they just were sick for 2 weeks in second grade and missed some big important piece, they're not reading well. So how can we help those students? So I think between my own experience as a teacher and then my experience as a child not being able to, or really struggling to learn to read, I want to do something to help out. So I've become a professor of literacy, and so now I teach undergraduate students who want to be teachers how to teach reading and writing so that they are better prepared than I was.
Kind of bring it back, so you're talking about middle school. How long did you teach in middle school?
I taught in middle school for 5 years. I started off in the Boston Public Schools, eventually moved down to Texas, and so I taught middle school there as well.
All right. And that's when you went to Texas A&M?
Yeah, so I was living one town over from Texas A&M and teaching there, and I think because I had so many students who were new to the country and just trying to catch themselves up. I mean, what do you do when you come? And if you're in middle school and you're trying to learn English for the first time, you're still expected to learn all your math, science, social studies, and English content and pick up a language. Like, that's a lot of pressure to put on a child.
Yeah, there's that barrier between learning.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, and so literacy, like, can you kind of explain, like, truly what you're teaching?
Sure. So I, here at Boise State, I teach an undergraduate course where my students are all, in addition to attending courses, they are teaching in the Literacy Lab here at Boise State. So the Literacy Lab is a program we run every fall and spring semester, and children from the community come in twice a week, and they're paired up either in small groups or on one-on-one, and they get tutored by one of the undergraduate students. So the undergraduate students get the support from myself and some from graduate assistants on how to assess and really figure out what's going on with this kid, and then gives them some really targeted interventions. So they're getting that literacy training that they'll need as teachers, and then the flip side, the children are getting support that they need as well to be successful in school. So it's kind of a win-win situation. So this semester we have almost 40 children who come in twice a week, grades, I think that our youngest are kindergartners all the way up to ninth grade, just trying to get some support, and everyone needs something different. So you never kind of know what kind of experience the undergraduates are going to get, but they get to plan lessons for real children before they're actually going out into the field themselves.
So you get to sort of teach new teachers how to be teachers to these students?
Yeah, and it's a lot of fun. So it's been really rewarding for me because it was really hard for me to make the decision that, yes, I was going to leave the classroom, not be a K-12 teacher anymore, to go and do this other career path. So I like that I get to still work with children. And some of the children have been coming now for all 3 years that I've been here at Boise State. So, you know, you don't get that as a K-12 teacher. You get them for a year.
Yeah.
So some of these kids now I've had and they've had tutors, not me, but still I've worked with them and seen them for 3 years now, and got to watch them grow and develop and build their motivation and build their confidence, and it's really rewarding.
So earlier you were saying that it was hard leaving K through 12. Mm-hmm. What made it hard?
You know, there's a shortage of teachers across the country. The average teacher turnover rate is about 5 years, and I hit exactly 5 years before I left, so there was part of me that felt like I was just adding to the statistic. The school I was teaching at when I left, I taught 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, and it was small enough that I had all the 6th, 7th, and 8th graders, so you know, the students who were in my 7th grade, they expected that they were going to have me for 8th grade.
Yeah.
And I knew them, I knew their families, and so when I told them I wasn't coming back in the fall, it was, I mean, I was crying. They, you know, it was tough. I feel like I'm a good teacher, and so it was really hard. I felt like I was abandoning the students. But now, A, I get to work with kids in the lab, which is really rewarding, but at the same time, too, whenever I see one of my undergraduate students pick up a strategy or a skill as a teacher, or they just ask a really good question and get a child to think about the book they're reading, I start doing this math in my head of, okay, if this person only teaches for 5 years, but they have 30 students per year, that's 150 kids.
Yeah.
So it's rewarding because I can think about, you know, the math on it, like how many kids am I impacting vicariously just by helping make sure that our students here at BSU are really prepared to be amazing literacy teachers.
And I actually like what you're doing. And earlier you said that you're a good teacher. So what makes you a good teacher?
It was one of these things I realized in my first couple years of teaching. I'm not the kind of person to be overly confident in a lot of things, but teaching has just kind of come naturally. I think, like I said, I struggled in school myself. So being able to take that step back and think about how to break down something that's complex, like something like reading, how can we break this down into the teeniest, tiniest little steps and pieces, and we're going to teach you one piece at a time so you can put the whole thing together, that's something I really excel at. I think of it almost like a puzzle. Like, you know, but instead of looking at the pieces of the puzzle and trying to put it together, I've got the whole puzzle, and how do I break it apart? And I really enjoy that challenge. I love finding ways, like if a student comes to me and you know they're not excelling for whatever reason, that process of trying to dig in and figure out, okay, what is the issue here? Is it a motivational issue? Do I just need to get you to love books? Fine, let's play that game, we'll figure that out. Or are you missing one little piece of knowledge that's gonna help all of this come together? So finding that out, or figuring that out is kind of just a mystery and a challenge that I really enjoy. And I think the other thing is I'm not perfect, and I tell my students I'm not perfect, I tell the children I'm not perfect, and I think because of that, students, be it children or the undergraduate still, yeah, students feel comfortable coming and talking to me.
Well, I feel comfortable talking to you today.
Thank you.
I kind of wish I would have had you as a teacher a little bit, because it seems like you go and you actually break down who the student is, not mm-hmm. just I have a bunch of students in the room, so I'm going to teach them the same way all the other students are.
Right. Well, it's hard because we teach all these best practices, and as a teacher, sometimes you see something works a bunch of times, and so in your head you go, okay, well, this is the way I should do it because it worked. And then you get a kid that it doesn't work for. And it can be really hard to be humble enough to say, oh, I don't have the answer right here. And I tell the undergraduate students in the lab that sometimes we get kids in there, and I'm not sure what to do with them, and I'm calling my friends. And, you know, there's a reading center still at Texas A&M. There's one at the University of Nevada. Like, calling colleagues and just asking, what do you think? And being willing to say, I don't know. I don't have the answers, but let's keep trying other things until we figure it out. And telling the children who are the ones who are struggling that if they're struggling, it's because I haven't found the answer, not because there's something wrong with them. Because we don't want the kids to give up
in
the meantime.
Because you want them to have at least the confidence to continue on, to know that they can still keep trying. They just have to try different areas.
Yeah.
so they can learn.
Exactly. I mean, I used to tell my middle school students, because they'd come in, you know, middle school students are a little bit argumentative just by nature, but I had a student that came in and said, I hate reading. I'm like, okay, so that's because someone, no one has found you the right book. Thank you for the challenge. And like, I'll spend the entire year, like, you know, and all I would say is, try a book, or try this book, and just, if you don't like it, that's fine, just tell me why so I can try to make a better recommendation for you. And it's the same thing with the skills. If a child is struggling to read, it's not because there's something wrong with them, it's because we haven't found the right strategies to help them. And we just have to keep trying. And even when it becomes behavior issues, like if a child's avoiding reading, it's because they've experienced failure. And we have to be patient with that and just try to figure out what to do next and how to build them back up and make them realize it's not their fault.
Yeah, hearing that is nice, to know someone like you is out there who's trying to teach these people to go out and teach the kids that there is always a way to teach them.
Yeah. I had a professor at A&M, and I totally agree that, you know, I have not met a child that can't learn to read, but that doesn't mean that they don't need more support or more strategies or just coming at it at a different angle.
So you were saying that you struggled mm-hmm. through school earlier, like way earlier.
Yeah.
How or why did you struggle in school?
I have a learning disability, so it's really interesting to look back now because my mother saved all the paperwork. So once I had my degree, she found it and was like, here, you know, so I could look at my own assessment results. I grew up in New Hampshire. At the time, New Hampshire did not recognize dyslexia as a diagnosis. So nothing on the paperwork says dyslexia, but I can look at it now and say, oh, they came up with another name. They called it a nonverbal language disorder, which I can look at now and say, oh, that was a bunch of teachers who wanted to make sure that I got the help I needed, but knew if they put down the wrong words that help wouldn't be available. So I was really lucky. My mom's a teacher. I had an amazing second grade teacher who kind of noticed that I was falling behind and off track. And she stepped in and got me the help I needed. So by the time I hit middle school, I wasn't receiving any more services through special education or anything like that. That didn't mean it was easy, you know, but I was able to work through a lot of it. But I can recognize now that I was lucky. I happened to be born in a place where we had a really strong education program. I had a mother who, also being a teacher, noticed that something wasn't going right and was able to advocate on my behalf. Not all kids have that. So we need to have teachers who are ready to do that advocacy for the children.
Well, I guess it appears that that's all the time we have tonight. Thank you for coming on the show.
Thanks so much.
It's really awesome. I'd like to thank my crew. Also like to thank my director, Bryson Schmidt, producer, Jill Norris, my studio manager, Bryce Campbell, or Cornwell, sorry. And next week we'll have Natasha, and she's going to be interviewing Professor Greg Heinzman. Sorry about that. And he teaches his students on refugee resettlement. So I guess that's all I have to say, so good night.